So today I'll do a hackathon to create a kind of a GitHub. It's like a kinda. In the first talk, he mentioned about GitLab. So it's same like if you cannot post on public server like GitHub or something. So you could actually have your own server and deploy the Git and use it. That thing. So
you can open up your class.
Okay, so about me, I'm backend developer in FasterCache. So FasterCache is promote means you can transfer money through social channel. So you can transfer some to some person on your friend if you know someone on WhatsApp or if you know someone on Facebook. So you don't need to know his complete bank account details. You can directly transfer using our FasterCache, product. So we actually deal with partnership with some banks or vendors which actually transfer money, and then we on top of that we use our APIs to allow them to transfer money across social channels. So I'm a backend developer in Java, but part-time also do Android development, and my part-time I've created ecobullet.com, which you can mirror notifications across devices. So if you have used PushBullet or heard of PushBullet, it's so through PushBullet you can transfer, means you can mirror your notifications from your device, Android device, to your system. But using EcoBullet, you can mirror your notifications across different devices from Android to Android or Android to iPad or something like that. Then some other apps like Torello, which you can transfer money on, transfer content to your Android watch, or TimeNotee and AppTag. So those are my free time projects. You can check sometime. So actually, before moving to the hands-on of how we actually create a JIT server, we'll know little about what's there. So main motive behind this presentation was we obviously can use GitLab or something like that, but if you know something deeper, means you know basic about it, then it's easier to grasp things. That's what I feel. So if you know something, okay, this is how it works. So in one of presentations previously in this meetup, we had a discussion about what's inside .git folder. So if you know already what's inside .git folder, so it will be a bit easier to understand how .git works. So same way, we'll go how actually a .git server looks like, how we can create one. So it will be easier for to use third-party tools like GitLab or anything like that. So starting with that, if you have a remote repository, it's mostly a bare repository. So we have two kind of repositories. One is a bare repository and other is non-bare repository. Non-bare repository is the general repository is what you guys worked on. So in your local machine, you'll be having where there's actual working version. You will be committing your files, you will be doing your stuff. So that's like a non-bare repository, or you can normally call it out working repository. And the other one is bare repository, where it's mostly for server side, means keeping the JIT content at the server side. So if you technically, it's if you see in your repository at the local, you'll find .jit folder. So basically not this bare repository is that same content in directly inside the folder. And usually you see when you create a one, it will be having like .jit extension. It's like just a convention we follow. So same way, like if you want to create a new bare repository, it's jit edit --bare. Or if you want to clone some other repository and create a new bare repository, you can directly call JIT clone dot on, dash dash pair in the URL. So if we can look at how it actually looks like. So if you want to create, so you can go inside it, test the JIT, and you do JIT, so we have initialized the empty JIT repository, and if you do ls, you will see the files which you usually see in .jit, .jit folder. These are all like head, branches, config. So obviously, that's why we keep it like that, because if you are pushing to a bare repository, then there will be no chances of conflicts, because there's no working copy there and in this bare repository. That's why we usually, means it's recommended that you always push to a bare repository. And actually we can JIT clone also this same. So we have cloned this empty repository. If you go inside it, if you do ls, there's a .jit folder, and if you look it inside that, it's exactly same what was there in the when you created one. So that's the most difference, means that's the major difference between a bare and a non-bare repository. So even after that, we can look at what are the protocols we can use if our bare repository is at the server. So what all protocols we can use and clone it in our local system. So we have like local protocol directly. So you can access a file, means access a repository directly. So like what I did, I just create a new bare repository and then I cloned it there itself in the local. So it wasn't like any server, it's directly at the local mounted hard disk. So that's local protocol. So if you can use it, if you have any mounted or a particular location, means which you can access across the teammates, so that you can go with the local protocol. Otherwise, there's HTTP protocol. So HTTP protocols is and this SSH protocol is a little tricky, because you have to create this key gen and all, and then you access with that. Definitely there are a lot of benefits of using SSH protocol, but with HTTP you can directly enter username, password, and access your repository, and those username, password also you can store in some keychain or something. So you need not have to enter those basic authentication passwords. Plus, HTTP protocol is like the same URL you will be able to access on your browser or something, and which will be same which you can use for the cloning of a repository. So that's HTTP protocol. Then SSH protocol, it's usually used when you are having your own repository. Plus, because if you have a remote server, definitely you will be having access of SSH to it. So you can directly start using with this SSH protocol. And JIT protocol is it's more or less similar to SSH protocol, but it's not authenticated. So it means it's mostly for public repositories. So same, we have this local protocol where you can directly JIT clone any particular location and work on it, and then directly push. So if we look at this one. So the origin is directly a local path user fastercast as torchit. So same HTTP protocol, it's very similar to SSH and JIT, but it runs over HTTP basic, and you can have your basic authentication rather than have to set up the SSH keys and all. And the pros, definitely it's single URL for all different type of access, and it's very fast and efficient, and but it's little tricky to set up. In this actually exercise, we'll be creating a repository where we'll be accessing through SSH protocol only. We'll be using this one, and it's common because mostly if you have any network, SSH probably will be already set up, so it's easy to access and secure. And the problem with this is you cannot have anonymous access because each one will be having his own SSH key, public key, and so you will know who have access it. Lack this JIT protocol is they have lack of authentication, difficult to set up, and it requires 9418 port to be opened, and which mostly corporate firewalls like don't means they have mostly closed it. So we'll set up a JIT server and JIT WAP. And previously, actually, I was thinking of giving on EC2 instance, AWS. But then, OK, it will be unfair for Google. So I plan, let's do it on Google Cloud. So yeah, so we can directly go on the terminal. So who all have worked on, means used Google Cloud? Okay, Google, okay. So actually I encountered it's even easier than EC2. If you create a new instance and all, it's very developer friendly. And so I've already logged in. So this is how the Google console looks like. You have lots of cards here. And what we are interested in is compute engine. Where is that? Okay, compute engines. So we'll start with like, from starting, we'll be creating a new instance. Let's create a new instance. We can give any name. Let's be instance 3. Zone is also fine. We can choose Istio. We can go with the cheapest one, which is Micro. So when you actually register with Google Cloud, they will give you $350 free gift, so you can definitely go check how Google Cloud works. Then we'll, instead of boot this, we can go with probably Ubuntu 16.4. Is it visible? Then for now, let's not allow HTTP traffic. But once we'll go to JIT WAP, then we'll go come here, and we can always come back here and change the settings. Okay, let's allow the HTTP traffic for now. You can add keys. So we'll be accessing it from here. So your keys, public key will be inside .ssh. This ID RSA, so you can directly give it here that I'll be accessing it from this key.
and let's create it. Plus, Google Cloud provides with this gCloud shell SDK toolkit, you can say, which you can use for logging to your clouds or creating new instances or anything through command line. So as I have already added my public key to this instance, I'll be able to log in directly. So do we have JIT here? Yeah, we have JIT already here. So we can create a new repository like JIT demo.git. So by convention, we'll follow the same .git. You can log in to coincide it. JIT demo JIT. We'll create a bare repository here. So we are ready with our server. So let's see if we can able to access it from my local machine. So it's JIT clone. So if you see, we already have JIT demo up and running. So congratulations, we already have a server ready with our remote bare repository. So now we can So if you see, we have our remote is to this IP and JIT demo.JIT. We can always create a new readme file. So we have pushed to the new instance. So now we have ready with one user, which is my local system and our remote server. But if if we have to give it to, means definitely there will be a collaboration, right? And there will be multiple people working on it. So so there are two ways you can actually add this. So one is you, like I added it here, my public key. So you probably, everyone will be knowing like how you'll be creating your public key, like normal sh keygen. It will be asking for your default location. You enter, you already have exist, overwrite, then enter passphrase, okay. And same passphrase, okay. So if you, what? Yes, so we'll figure it out. So we'll have to add it again probably. So cat. So can always add it again. So we can go add it, delete this one, add this one. So same way, so I have another instance also. So like search. Probably I've deleted it. So basically, so you added, you created this key, and instead of going over there and add it like manually, you can always go inside here, ls.sh and known. Authorize keys. So you can directly add those keys here, and the other people will be able to access this repository. Then there's another problem, like now if I added everyone's public key in this repository, so everyone can access this, and the problem which we are facing with the local, keeping a local repository, local protocol, that anyone can go inside and delete the dot means the files, they can corrupt the files. So probably we wanted something, so I added those keys, but he should be able to do only JIT or clone or push or pull, but not able to directly SSH log into it. So JIT comes with JIT shell. So you can keep your default shell to a particular user to JIT shell. So it will only allow you to clone or push pull to that repository. You won't be able to SSH to it. So there will be like a only particular user who will be having access to that machine. Not everyone will go and can change the content there. So that's it for the part where we actually have set up a JIT server. We're able to clone and push and pull our changes. Then comes, we need something because JIT web means JIT hub has a nice UI also. So we need something, some basic to it. So we can always do a JIT web setup, which is already there for provided by the JIT. So I have some commands ready for me. We can. So I'll be installing the Apache here. So if you go check, so currently there's nothing. So we'll install Apache. So we have set up the Apache here. So we need to clone this JIT repository, so which is having our this JIT web. We need to install make also, because for the further step we need to forgot to get in. So if here we can see this JetWap project root, so that's the path which you have to give where all of your repositories are present. So that's the, so because our repository are inside at the home, so that's why it's home Ubuntu here is JitWap project root. So now we have this JitWap ready, so we can move it to access by Apache. So there will be a CGI script, so we need to enable running CGI scripts. So that's, this command is for that, and you need to restart after doing that. And plus, we'll add a virtual host for it. So if you do, there's a, this default file, you can, so sudo vi. So there's already one virtualhost present. We can comment it out for a while. So here we are opening the 80 port, which will be pointing to JIT where www.jitwap, where we just copied the files, and we need to execute CGI scripts. That's why we have to give the options execute CGI, and we are adding the handler here, CGI scripts, to run it. And where's the index? It's jitwap.cgi. So if we go inside this one. Which we just copied. So there are this jitwap.perl and jitwap.cgi file, which we are going to execute. So now we have actually added a virtual host, and we have enabled this CGI script. So we need to restart our Apache. So now if we go and see, wow. Let's go. Yes, put pointing to 80, right? Will there be issue in tabs and spaces? No, right?
No, it's a half there. Is it half correct?
JITwap, correct.
Have you enabled the CGI module?
Yep. That's inside failed compilation border at JITwap. It should be fine. Anyway, means I. So there's one. This I have published this on Medium. It's this one is on EC2 instance, and so it will look like something like this when you have this running. So here are basic things are here, like you can search based on SHA, you can list all your projects here. Then if you go inside your project, you can search based on commit, grab, author, committer. So it's a basic UI, which you probably will be needing for JIT. There's no CI or anything like fancy stuff, but yeah, basic UI for it. So that's it. So, yeah.
So with JITwap, how do you create a repository on the server?
I think GitPub is only for read-only. You won't be able to create a new repository.
So with Git shell, could you create a new repository on
server? Git shell or just a normal shell you are talking about?
Git shell.
Git shell.
Yeah.
Probably, I'm not sure. From normal shell, definitely you can create.
But you don't want your team to have normal SSH access.
Oh, that way you are saying. Yeah, probably you'll be able to create.
In Git shell as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it should be.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Yeah. Would you say that Git web repository browsing is faster than Git maps?
Probably should be, because now it's actually more depend on your server which you are using, server capability, because everything is yours, local, and plus I've used my micro based on servers and all performance, that's the thing, I think. So basically, GitLab will be a better option if you are trying to host, because it comes with a huge community and a lot of other fancy tools also. This is something which I gave presentation, because if you know basic how the server is working, how you are actually communicating the server, what all protocols are there, what are repositories, kind of repositories, bare and non-bare, what's the difference between that. So it's easier to play with a toy which you know what the toy is and how it works. So that was the main objective of having this presentation. So any other question? Thank you.